Hi, Mark Phillips here. Welcome to another video wine blog. Today's video is about tasting wine. Well, tasting wine, but the third step in the four-step tasting process, which is taste. So it's tasting wine, the tasting wine process. Anyway, tasting wine, finally, you know, we like to smell the wine. That is such a key step in smelling wine. We have the appearance, the aroma, and then the taste. Now, there are two parts, an A and a B, to tasting wine, to the actual flavor of the wine, or the taste of the wine. Feeling and flavor. I'll start over again. Hi, Mark Phillips here. Welcome to another video wine blog. This is the third video in the series of the four-step wine tasting process. And today's video is about taste, the third step. The first was the appearance, the second the aroma, the third is taste, and the fourth is the aftertaste, which was discussed in video number one. So this is on taste. And there are two components to tasting wine: feeling and flavor. The feeling of wine is the tactile sensation. I always want to do this on camera. The tactile sensation left in your mouth after you swallow the wine. And there are only two feelings in wine: acidity and tannin. Acidity, usually most detectable in white wines, not so much red. It's in red wines, European wines mostly, but mostly in white wines you pick up that acidity more. And acidity, if a wine's got acidity, you'll feel in the back side of your tongue. The back side of your tongue, where salivating ducts are. And there's another salivating duct area right down here in your lower gum area. When acidity, it could be lemon, other acids, tomato in food, but when you put that in your mouth, it makes you salivate when acidity hits those. So the most sensitive ones are back there. But if the wine's got a lot of acidity, this will be activated and you'll start salivating. If a wine's got a ton of acidity, you may start drooling. Saliva may overflow out of your mouth and down all over your outfit, so you have to be careful. Okay, maybe that's a little carried away. So anyway, acidity. You'll feel it. It's not a taste. You'll feel it by salivating. You'll feel it in the backside of your tongue mainly. And the other feeling, tannin, is really only in red wines. Again, it can be in white if a white wine's put in oak barrels, and sometimes the oak creates tannin in the wine, but mostly it's in red wines. And tannin makes your mouth completely dried out like cotton mouth. In fact, there'll be, if a wine's got a lot of tannin, going like that, trying to get saliva back into your mouth again, like when you're really nervous on stage or something. Your mouth dries out. So that tannin creates that. And that dry feeling. And so, you know, if it's acidity or tannin, they both dry your mouth out in a way, but the acidity adds the saliva to it. It dries it out, but then simulates the salivating ducts. And tannin just dries it out. You know, a wine writer might say a wine's really chewy that's got a lot of tannin because you're trying to get saliva back in your mouth. So the feeling of wine, why would anyone care about that wacky feeling? Because the feeling of wine is really the number one consideration in my mind in matching wine and food. So if you want to ever become a real pro at matching wine and food, you have to understand the feeling of wine. Now, how do you get that? Because if you're drinking wine like this, drinking wine, and you swallow, you won't notice the feeling as much. Yeah, you'll pick it up a little bit, but not as much. And that's why the tasting process is there, to really draw out what's in the wine. Now, if you're drinking the wine and don't pick it up, why would you care about drawing it out? the tasting process? I don't have a really good answer for that, except it's cool to understand the wine better. If you're not picking up that acidity, I think it can help you too in understanding the wine better, the properties of wine. And even though you may not detect the acidity or the tannin so much when you're drinking the wine, it's there and it will interact with food. So it's just good to understand how it is and how your mouth feels when you experience that. So it's important to do. I still believe it's important to taste the wine and do this process to understand the feeling and the flavor, because even though you may not notice it when you're drinking the wine as much, it's still good to have that reference point. So the way to understand the feeling of wine when you're tasting it in this third step process, 3A, so I'm going to put wine in my mouth and mouthwash it all over like mouthwash. I'll do it for you first. All over. After I swallow, wow, I'll feel the inside of my mouth doing something. Now, a white wine or red wine doesn't have acidity or tannin, or does. That's a bad way to put it. Acidity is, in a white wine, is not there or not. Well, I'm having a hard time saying that. It's a continuum. I'll just say that. It's a continuum. It's not either there or not. It's usually there's some acidity, at least in a white wine, hopefully. I guess some wines really have very little acidity, but it's usually a continuum, and you're trying to understand how much acidity, where that acidity falls in that continuum. Same with tannin. It's not that a wine has tannin or doesn't have tannin, it's how much tannin it has. So you want to think in those terms, not either or. Okay? So it's kind of goofy making that sound of mouthwash, but if you have some wine, try it on the next wine you have. If you're having wine right now, perfect, white or red. Taste some wine first and just swallow it without mouthwashing. Then put a little more wine in your mouth and mouthwash. Whoa, what a difference there'll be. You'll see a huge difference of what you pick up out of the wine. So that mouthwash is key to understand the feeling of wine. You're looking for acidity and or tannin. All right, then comes 3B, flavor. You can drink wine and get the flavor of wine. I'll drink some more because I like drinking wine. I love drinking wine. And I like this wine. It's got a nice flavor to it, not too complex. I can even analyze it pretty well without having to do the tasting process. But once you do the tasting process, you can get more out of it. It adds a whole other dimension to it. And the way to get more flavor out of the wine, instead of just putting it in your mouth and swallowing it, is going to follow the same principle of the aroma step, number two, that when you swirl the wine, the air opens up the wine. Air opens up wine anyway. That's why wine breathes. We might want to make a wine breathe, decant the wine, because it opens it up. So we're going to follow that same principle and get the flavor of the wine. When I put this wine in my mouth, instead of just swallowing it, I'm going to suck air in while the wine's in my mouth. And that air going across the wine in my mouth is going to aerate that wine in my mouth and send the aeration, the aroma basically, up my retronasal passage to my nasal cavity, and that's where you taste wine. It's the craziest thing. The salt, sweet, sour, bitter receptors in the tongue don't play a big role in tasting wine. That's not what you want to think about in tasting wine. It all happens up here in your nasal cavity. If you have a cold, you can't taste wine. You're dinked. You have to really get the flavor. You have to suck that air in and send that wine up into your nasal cavity. Well, the aroma of the wine into the nasal cavity. I mean, if you could put the wine and drink it right through your nose and get to your nasal cavity, that'd be a lot faster and easier. But that's hard to do. You can try it. Put a straw in the wine and then and see what that's going to be like. Not pleasant. So an easier way, albeit though it's a little bit goofy, yeah, when putting this wine in your mouth, it's going to make a weird sound, but it's how it should be done. So I'm going to do it for you first here to show you how it's done. Wow. Okay, so that wasn't very good. But did you hear the gurgling sound it made when I... Wow, that's a, I might get a little teary-eyed. Wait a minute. Do you hear that gurgling sound you make when I was making, when I sucked the air in? That's how it's supposed to happen. But if your chin is up like mine was, oh, did I just burp right there? Maybe you didn't hear that, but I kind of had that internal burp from gagging on the wine. If your chin's up and you suck the wine in, suck the air in, some of that wine may leak down to your throat and make you gag and worse, spew. And if it's red wine and you have people around you at a dinner party or something like that, wow, way bad. So you do want to suck the air in, but you don't want to have your chin up because some of that wine will leak down to your throat. So the real proper way to do it, I did it for you the wrong way, and that's why I gagged. The proper way is to put the wine in your mouth, put your chin down against your chest. Now, the wine shouldn't drool out on you, and that's the idea, and it really doesn't. And then suck the air in. So here's the right way to do it. Here we go. And I can go on forever that way because the chin's down and the wine will not get into my throat. Now, it makes a goofy sound, sure. And you won't be doing this at a dinner party or at a restaurant. You're not supposed to be doing that, really, because that's for drinking wine, not for tasting wine. But when you do this, if you have some wine, I want you to try tasting the wine. Just put it in your mouth and swallow it. Don't suck any air in for before and after. And then put some more wine in, put your chin down, and suck the air in. And you'll be amazed at the difference and how much flavor you get out of the wine. Now, it may not be a better flavor. It may not be. Because what this is doing is you're really trying to pick apart the wine, dissect the wine to see what's really about. So, now what if you don't like the taste of the wine when you suck the air in, but you like the taste of the wine when you're drinking it? Well, the drinking's the most important still. I mean, that's fine. But if you really just want to try to analyze the wine, understand the whole part of wine, because this is what you're trying to do, is understand, you know, where it comes from, the year it was made, the grape variety, and all that stuff. Tasting wine gives you a better reference point of that than just drinking wine. So in the third step, the taste step, we have the feeling and the flavor. It should be done with one mouthful of wine. So again, the tasting process would be, of course, the appearance, tilt the glass away, and then the aroma, swirl and sniff. And now the taste, one mouthful of wine for both the feeling and the flavor. Here we go. There we go. And I feel it, I taste it. That's the third step, feeling and flavor. Now, what do you say about that then? Once you do it, and that's for another video coming up, how to talk about wine, how to describe wine. But right now, I also make sure you know the tasting process. And now you know all four steps. And my charge to you, really, I promise, what will change your life more than reading all the books on the market, watching my stupid videos or anything, is for you to go through the four-step process on every wine you taste. I don't care if it's box wine, jug wine, inexpensive wines, whatever. Every wine you taste for the rest of your life, promise me right now, promise me, Mark, I promise I'll do it. It will help you immensely in understanding wine, more than any other thing you can do. Really. Even if you have no idea what you're doing, just to do it, because you'll see huge differences in wine. Do that four-step process. Make a note of what you're tasting in your mind, on paper, whatever you want to do, of the year it was made, the grape variety, and where it comes from, and the cost, those four things. Because you'll see the differences, and after a while, all become clear. At first, you might think, what? I don't know. But after a while, it'll all start falling into place that certain, the cost of wine will have this kind of sensation of the four steps. Where the wine comes from will be this way, and the color and the flavor and stuff. You'll pick up stuff. And once you get a handle on that, whew, you're golden. You're there. You've made it. You've arrived in the world of wine to understand wine. You'll never understand wine, I promise you, unless you taste a zillion wines. Unless you do that four-step tasting process on really every wine you have. And that's the way to do it. Not reading books, believe me. Not, well, going to wine tastings, yes, and then tasting the wine. Not drinking wine, not reading books. You have to taste wine. You have to. And it's fun to do anyway. It's like a hard thing to do. Oh, this could be torture because of the four-step process. No, it's easy. And it's fun because you'll see such huge differences. So every wine you have for the rest of your life, do the four-step tasting process. On the first taste, at least. And then if a second glass is poured, pour a little bit first. The second glass, do it again. Quickly. And if you're out in public somewhere, you know, I'm exaggerating what you do, the mouthwash and sucking the air and stuff like that, but you can do it very discreetly. If I was at a restaurant, here's what I would do. Well, again, it depends. I mean, I wouldn't do it at a restaurant, but here's what I'd do. Done. People are talking, not paying attention. They wouldn't hear me do anything. They wouldn't hear any of that. I put it down, I'd be very discreet about it, but I still get the benefit of doing that mouthwash and sucking air in to really pick up what's going on with the wine. So there you go, taste, very important. Aroma, also very important, both the second and the third step, key to understanding wine. That's all, see you.